The first session. So it was supposed to be delivered on March 29, but more and more people jump on board. And so I always give time to them. So I push myself off and off and off until today. Looks like if you guys continue, I will be pushed off.
I apologize, Jason.
Okay, anyway, the topic, the perspective I want to talk is totally different. If Peter's focus on anatomy, I mean, to analyze what's going on in a detailed schisma, I tend to see things from outside, from a functional or productive, production-oriented view. So it's like in a big black box there. I focus on what the black box do, what the black box does, instead of opening it and cutting it into pieces. So the topic is the localness limit that was attract me, because when he talked about local fear, I agree that the term field might not be that appropriate, but I like the localness and the limit of X. Here, X is a collection of consciousness, cognition, knowledge, science, and wisdom, everything. What I want to say is, we must acknowledge that this everything here has a limit, and it's locally limited. So Francis and the Shima's draft paper triggered my response as a tongue twister description, which goes like that. A local observer observing a limited, thus incomplete amount of information, reaching to imperfect knowledge about the what's and the why's, and producing a non-optimized plan of how to do things for his or her action that sometimes works, but most of the times leading to unintended consequences. So this linked back to some of our previous sessions focusing on the unintended consequences produced by system thinking or non-system thinking or narrow system thinking. So my focus is this limitedness, localness, and the incompleteness. So my point of this presentation is to target a widespread theme of academics. That is to say, the assuming there exists ideal global truth, no matter what that truth is, a fancy model or fancy metaphor or fancy distinction drawing methods or whatever you call it, it's not global. So that kind of ivory tower thinking can eventually lead us to, it's a misunderstanding, it leads us to disasters. So that's the point I want to make. So to me, consciousness is much simpler than the list Peter gave under that five category. To me, consciousness equals waking up, open eyes, starting booting up my cognition system. And then it equals seeing, hearing, and my knowledge base being activated. So knowing, so a more reliable knowing would be what we call science. So science equals knowing reliably. And the last one is wisdom. Wisdom is simply equals to survive better. So that's my simple way of seeing the thing. So I want to expand this X into X apostrophe to a little bit more detailed into eight levels. First would be perception. Second would be measurement. But yeah, After you perceive something, you make some rational effort to measure it, right? You count and you measure. And then after measurement, you have this magic thing called the data, right? And after you more interpretation of your data, you have this something called information, the difference that makes the difference. And then information accumulated, developed into something we call knowledge. And the knowledge leads to understanding, aha, and understanding leads to what we call science, and eventually, hopefully, wisdom. So this eight level perception is, you just mentioned the sensory process through the whole schematic and get into your motory actions. But for the perception level, we have our sensory boundaries, right? All five senses all have a limited zone the capacity of testing something, getting the signal. Beyond that zone, beyond that boundary, like a supersonic, you cannot hear. And infrared, you cannot see. Infrapurple, you cannot see. So that is the boundary. And in psychology, there is a work, they won the what they call laughable Nobel Prize, or ridiculous Nobel Prize. But I think the study is very interesting. The book's named Invisible Gorilla. So that phenomenon I observe a lot in reality. And also further, there's a Dunning-Kruger effect. People all have misperceptions, this type and that type. So the first level, you already have all these limitations. And the second level, at the measurement level, well, you have a Heisenberg uncertainty principle. You have a certain area that even Webb telescope cannot go through. So in measurement, you also have a limit. You have a boundary. On the data, you have your sample size, you have a statistical errors, validity errors, reliability errors, etc. And in information level, you have the echo chamber, you have an information cocoon, you have your focused, your preferred area of information that are willing to get to accept. But you probably also deny something that is not consistent with your existing knowledge scheme. So everywhere, a knowledge, and at a knowledge level, you have a participatory bias, you have a Gordon's law, you have Arrow's law. In understanding level, you have huge diversity in constructivist construction. So we just had one example, a Boris construction about what's really going on, and Peter's construction of what's going on. They're very diversified. So different opinions. So here you have limitations. And in science, I tried to classify four different types of science. Version one focused on discovering nature laws. Version two focused on finding social consensus. And version three focused on finding the best gaming strategies. And version four is largely a remote area. It's all about counter-existential threats. This term called unrestricted, unlimited wars. And in this area, all the previous science won't work. There's something new needs to be developed here. And lastly, wisdom. And Lao said that wisdom once said is not universal. So slightly we are hopelessly, we cannot reach that final point. I just give one example at the first level of the previous stage. This is at a perception level. Here you have this turning circle. They are perfectly circled, no change at all. But what your eye is telling your brain is hugely influenced by this arrow. See, when it points to here, you see it's going there. When it points there, you see that going up and it's expanding, shrinking. I like this example very much because it revealed the secret of your brain completely cheating you without your awareness. I just need to give one example. So the other seven levels, if you're interested, well, we can figure them out in another session. So my emphasis is this limit, localness limit acts, or no matter you put it all in more general term or you in a higher resolution, more detail, they are metaphors here. They are like red traffic lights that we should not go in beyond. We should not go beyond them. If you want to violate that, it leads to disasters and risks life. So, ultimate goal of academic intellectual work, whatever we are doing here, actually is to attain some kind of wisdom. We all agree, right? So what is exactly wisdom? The previous slide says, Lao said, okay, forget about that. But still we have about 100 or 101 definitions of wisdom. So mine here is wisdom equals effectiveness and efficiency of action, judgment, without or minimize, if you cannot do without, to minimize unintended consequences. For example, Jamie, you had a lot of judgment through your email that produced unintended consequences that shut down the conversation instead of continuing it. That's just one simple example. So, if you do not have any action, if you have no judgment, that's irrelevant with wisdom. If the stuff is non-effective, you have not get any wisdom. If the efficiency is low, that's a very poor wisdom. And if you're running into unintended consequences, it's a very poor wisdom. Unfortunately, we see them everywhere, all in our world. So my message is going beyond one's LLX equals fatal conceit, which is not wisdom. Wisdom almost equal to God's perspective. And the Lord said you cannot get it. So why should I make this point triggered by Francis's work? We have this frequently observed academic things. One is we disrespect the touch limit, think that we are building some kind of a silver bullet, the illusion of a panacea. And we have an attitude of, yeah, I invented this, I am right. Wait a minute. It's not a good control of my mouse. Okay, yeah, you means I am right, you are wrong. Okay, both Peter and Boris had a little bit of that. I am right, you are wrong. So that will kill conversation. If we could avoid that actively, then we can make an effort to keep conversation going on. And there's a mistake of a hunt. Okay, hidden assumption, which is not true. Hidden assumption, which is not true. We almost always forget about that, and that will lead to mistakes. Addiction to monologue, solo talk, and ignoring questions from peers. That is exactly why we organize our Club of Remy into three-person conversation format instead of just one big name doing a presentation, doing a lecture, answer some questions, that sort. So I think that's a thing as well. Now, academic self-entertainment is even worse. We have this kind of members, I don't say who, inventing new concepts, new models, very fancy, very complicated, and then without making applications of them in the real world. So that's my proposal, is we need to be alert. Don't commit these. Instead, we can possibly repair, fix them by, number one, be aware of that boundary. Focus on local topics, and then assume noble intent of other perspective and respect the perceptions of others different from yours. And once if we can do that, we give up the effort of persuading the others. Okay, we can agree to disagree and let time tell. Third one is to remember checking assumptions. Fourth one is to practice listening and active listening. Build on each other's questions, keep responses short. Well, we heard frequently that comment become a long monologue that lost people's attention. So keep the response short, is merit. Always work on applications, science without engineering retreats to philosophy. So whatever you are promoting, please think, how would you apply that in real world situation? So there is a little bit of sidetrack, is that I think there is an opinion fact spectrum. You need to be always aware, where are you? And science departure from philosophy enables fact finding, natural law finding, and to be more important than opinions. So opinions thus evolve into format of a hypothesis. So whenever you have a strong thought, try to form it into a hypothesis and accept testing. What Popper said, demarcation, experimentation. So that's why I emphasize action. And so I suggested here last month at a conference in UK that I suggest that we replace system thinking with system altering. Observer thinking, action altogether. So if you cannot do it altogether, you must be very careful. Therefore, there is an opinion fact spectrum there. We must be aware of the ratio of the fact or opinion of what you say. And of course, everybody has hope. He says, oh, well, when I do academic research, I hope that I can do blah, blah, blah. So here, I would like to highlight that, there are something I call imperfection everywhere. We are not aware of it enough. The imperfection lives with us, not as we designed, wished, hoped for, dreamed of. It is vitally important that we understand that these imperfections are the inseparable elements of the world. So for the children, they wake up from a Disney world, from fairy tales, and for the young adult, they wake up from a Hollywood world. And these Disney world and the Hollywood world represent some true elements of our hope, but they never complete. We have to limit this localness, this imperfection putting together. We can have less hype. We can have more hands-on solutions. So that's about the conclusion. There's an A word created by irresponsible intellectuals, ideology, or political leaders who ignore LX and imperfect. So this is worse than Disney World and the Hollywood World. Academic world sometimes lead to more unintended consequences. So that's the trigger I got from Francis's work. So in this perspective, I think we are joining this group of people. This is Mises, this is Hayek, this is Gordon, this is Popper, and this is Alcoff, and these are all dead people. And the living one, you have Thomas Sowell here, and you have Francis here, and I'm 3 years older than Francis, so I put myself here. We need to stop that conceit that leads to unintended consequences. We need more people working on awareness of these limitations. So that's my presentation. Jim, you raised your hand. You're muted.
Yes, thank you, Jason. And I hope you will, if that's okay, that you will share the slides.
Yeah, I can say the truth.
Yeah.
No problem.
But I think you missed one important thing, and that is the gestalt switching. This in your list of five items, like I'm right, therefore you're wrong, because there is a gestalt switch that it doesn't matter what someone says. If the is thinking he's trying to dominate me, he never will listen. Just that he reads everything, every email that is come, he thinks, oh, this is a personal attack on my views, therefore I need to respond. So the switching needs to go to what Popper said, to realize a lot of people are in the framework of I may be wrong, you may be right, and together we get to the truth. So
that's so my this, proposal.
But that is gestalt switching. And gestalt switching is not taken serious in the psychology literature, because they all try to come up with some computational type model. And gestalt switching, that is a drone that suddenly starts killing the drone operators. There's a switching of gestalt from friend to enemy, from enemy to friend. And well, in a machine that switches gestalt, that is killed, that is immediately taken out of circulation, or people say the machine is being hacked, or they call it a stochastic process. But it is not at all. So a machine cannot explain the phenomena of gestalt switching. That is just what I'm trying to say. Gestalt switching is a unique advanced feature of the human mind that is best studied when people are reading.
I think we had this conversation before, and I asked you a question that you never answer. My question was, what would be a facilitative step-by-step procedure that people can use to switch their gusto? And I don't think you have the answer. And
I have been trying to give you an answer, and I will give it again. But it requires one to read.
No.
I got another answer from
an expert. And he studies he's very close to Peter's field. He studies brain processes and the neural network thing. There is a concept called neural network pruning. Pruning is like you're pruning a tree. Okay. And if that happens, then you have your gusto switch. Now, in reality, my observation says that if that really happened, reading books is kind of ineffective, inefficient. But the real gusto switch we observed in reality, almost all involve heavy pen. Heavy pen. So very strong emotional strike will wake people up.
So
what will be a feasible procedure or step that one can do the gusto change if they are willing to do that? That's still the pending question. Reading is not an answer.
Can I say, so that is done where we are stuck, because you don't think reading is relevant to the human civilization. And I'm coming from Popper to say it's extremely relevant, and something went wrong in the 13th century when they trivialized the written word. And if I may say, for you to put Mises below Popper, then you have absolutely no clue about the dynamics between Mises and Popper, because they didn't get along at all. They were in the same room.
You have a misunderstanding there. Look at their age. I put this from their birth time.
Yeah.
So the oldest guy born in 1881. And then one is younger than the younger one's going to us. Okay, so that's your misperception of yours, not my problem.
Mises doesn't belong there, because Popper's philosophy is all like Robert.
I'm Merton not talking said. About the same philosophy here. I'm talking about a common theme that they are pointing out to your conceit. Faithful.
Yeah, but in order to call something a conceit, you make a judgment. And the whole point of a gestalt switch is that you look different at something instead of making a judgment. And that is the difference between Popper and Mises. That Mises was all the time... another way to say that, if that's more helpful, is Robert Merton. Kenneth Boulding, who say, if you look at tomorrow's, if we knew the content of tomorrow's newspaper, half of it would be empty. And that is to emphasize there always will be unintended, undesirable, unanticipated consequences. And to kind of say we can bring them to zero is just not understanding the human condition. Yeah, sorry.
Boris?
Yes.
What do you think?
Can I ask something?
Peter.
Yes, I think that when Margaret is angry, is very sympathetic. Very, very.
Very what?
I said when Margaret is angry, is very sympathetic, you know. I would like to say that if we don't agree about some issue, or if we don't agree what is really in reality, what we could do? I think that we should look other opinions, maybe, and then determine it, who is right, who is wrong. And how would we do? Who would we call to determine it, to determine it whether we are right or wrong? Can we agree that we have to co-opt experts from science, from specific science we are talking about? One problem. If we are talking about nervous system, who can we co-opt to explain how nervous system works? Who is the best to explain nervous system?
There is no best.
Can I,
Peter, who? Who is the best? Who can explain nervous system?
Look, no, I think there are very few people on the scene who are trying to put it all together. I think you have to look at a bunch of people, and they're going to have differing ideas. I don't think there's any one authority who has it all, you know.
Who knows? Okay, let it put like this. Who knows the most about nervous system?
There are some people in IISS. The next president, Gary Smith. He did an interesting summary. I can send you his link. And of course, there are huge disagreement to answer. Yeah. Or
Jason,
question.
It depends on which group
you're coming from.
I mean, you need a neuroscientist, basically. And, you know, there are people who have very high-level, expansive views of things who have actually worked on, you know, looking at what neurons do. But no one person, I think, has the whole thing worked out. I don't know of any system scientists that know much about the nervous system.
Okay, where did neuroscience get knowledge? Neuroscience took knowledge.
People did experiments. They cut up brains. You know,
okay.
And Golgi.
Show me experiments in neuroscience. Show me experiments. Who made the most experiments with nervous system? Who is making the most experiments with nervous system every day? Who is operating nervous system every day? Who knows the most about nervous system?
This is a rhetorical question. Are you saying we all do?
There are neuroscientists.
That's Boris.
There are millions of them who are who knows about nervous system the most. Medical workers. They know the most about human body and then know the most about nervous system.
No.
Believe me.
Neurologists know a great deal. But they don't necessarily know much, and they're not focused on what's going on, how it
they
works.
They know the most about it. They are doing it every day. Every day experiments, every day. What kind of experiments does neuroscience have?
So people are observing the brain.
Show them to me. Show them to me experiments. show experiments to me. Most knowledge is stolen from physiology. Of nervous system, from neurophysiology and so on. And you know what is the main problem with neuroscience? It is studying only the nervous system. But if you want to study the nervous system, you have to study the whole body, the whole human being.
Yes.
Because the nervous system was born in the body of the living beings. You know, it's evolutionary. Came nervous system logically from the functioning of the organism, you know?
Yeah.
That's why we need a good historical review. I think starting from McCullough Pitts, through people like Maturana, on the pigeons, blah, 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 all the way to today's artificial intelligence work, copying the neural network algorithms. That is needed. If Boris, if you could do such a review,
networks are not, they don't resemble real neurons or real nervous systems.
They're models. That's so true. Really, and how do we know about the models? Because we read, Jason, all the people. I thought that's where you were going, Boris. Everyone learns about it because they're reading. And if I may say, the Kruger-Dunning effect, for me, that's the biggest joke. How you dare to call that a scientific theory? Because if you look up the definition, it says incompetent people overestimating their competence. Now, that's the human condition to call that a... We all have an opinion about something we don't know. And for some guy to do an experiment and say, well, there's sometimes incompetent people having an opinion about something they shouldn't have an opinion about. For me, that is an expert who doesn't want to listen to a man on the street who says, you're full of hot air, you're full of shit. What you're saying has nothing to do with reality. And that, Jason, is what you're trying to say, that the expert should stop acting as if they're above conversation. And reading is what is educating the man on the street. And so that's my opinion.
Can I say something, Margaret? Okay, reading. What reading? Anything or something special?
Can I give an answer?
Bullshit.
Boris, that is where we have systems theory with feedback feed forward loops. And it starts when you learn to read and the teachers that teach you how to read and that teach you how to make a distinction between a good and a bad book. And it literally starts in when a child is 4 years old and you teach it the principles of logical reasoning. And then when they become 60 years old, they're able to somehow make a distinction between a book that is going somewhere and a book that is going nowhere. But that starts very early. And that is a system science perspective that acknowledges that a mother, if she needs to work, and she's all alone, she won't have time enough to have conversations with her child. So you have to look at the entire system, as you point out.
We already 10 minutes past the time. Peter, you have some final conclusion?
I just had about three comments on your part. First is just, some of us don't like acronyms, and just please spell out your acronyms on your slides, because I forget them. Frustrating.
Peter, can you make it louder? I don't hear you.
Oh well, the gain on my I'll shout louder. So please spell out the acronyms on your slides. That
Okay. I will send your slide.
Peter, very good.
The second point.
No problem.
I don't think wisdom is necessarily correlated with efficacy per se. If you have a lot of bad choices, it still can be wise to choose the least worst of them, even if none of them are very good. And the third was, I think we agree. On your sequence of opinion, hypothesis, and fact is parallel to what I proposed in my verificationist paper, in that you have a phase of scientific development where you use the imagination and you enlarge the possibilities. And then there's a refinement phase where you throw out the most crazy of the possibilities and you refine the internal coherence of your thinking. And then you propose specific testable hypotheses. And then there is a testing phase where you test the hypotheses experimentally or against observed evidence, and then those hypotheses that fit the evidence are verified in some sense. So we want to so the notion of fact as verified assertion is how I would think about it. So I think that that's really important. Always when we say anything or we make any assertions, whether we are doing it in the kind of imaginative heuristic mode or poetic mode, shall we say, or whether we're doing it in terms of a coherent, you know, theory or worldview, or whether we're talking about something as an established, empirically established fact. So that's all that I have to say, I think. Thank you for inviting us.
Well, don't forget to attend next session by Boris. Boris is going to talk about how brain works. So that would be very interesting.
Do you have a date for that?
We do. Look back at the meeting reminders.
Okay. Is it this month or next month or?
Let me have a quick
look. Boris, do you know?
I don't yet hear well.
I don't recall having seen it, but there was one more.
November 29.
Oh, all right. Okay.
November 29.
There was one other point. You know, I'd love
to
hear.
Will you come?
Instead of just giving the names.
Will
of
you
people,
come 29 or forever to talk about brain functioning?
I'll come. I'll harass you.
Yes, you may. Yes.
I'm
asking Margaret if she'll come.
Okay.
Jason, I will call.
One last request. When you put up people who have influenced you, you
please
need to
come, Margaret, please.
Jason, go
ahead, Peter. Sorry.
Just a small request. Jason, when you put up this slide of people who have influenced you, it's not so much who they are, but I want to know how they influenced you, what ideas you got from them. And you know,
all this stop conceit.
Francis, for example,
they are all from different angle, but the function or the productivity I see is this effort, and this effort is consistent with what I have been talking about here about the limitations of self-aware of our limitations of academic models, metaphors, distinctions, okay, judgments, whatever.
All right. Good.
Okay. So it's 10:15 now. We need to close.
Yeah. Boris, this, I have been part of this meeting since the first one. So if that helps explain the liberty I took I should have been very composed and I should have asked questions instead of immediately starting to talk about the importance of reading. But I've known Jason and Peter for a while, I hope that it explains a little bit of the dynamics. And
yeah, we have been arguing all the time. That's pretty good exercise.
Margaret, can I answer you something? When you're reading something, is it important who wrote it?
No, absolutely not.
It's not.
No, that is the way that I discovered it. It was someone I hadn't no clue who he was. no one in my environment cared about him. Everyone thought it was totally irrelevant. No one forced me to read it. It was someone who made sense. And that person actually was working with distinctions, getting back to Peter's presentation. And he really made me self-aware of the distinctions with which I was working. And he wrote well.
So it's not important who is writing the book. He can have an imaginational book. He can write about fairy tales. That is not important.
No, my dear Boris, you don't get the point. The book is well written. The book is written well. And if the book is written well, but you still need to do the effort of reading. Now, if you can't read, then I can't help.
No, it's important who wrote something, you know, because we are reading what you are interesting to read. It's important what is written there, you know.
What is written?
No, it's reading everything.
My different strategy is I don't read books. I just tie them together and carry the book instead of just read them. Okay, thank you very much. See you next time.
One more answer to Boris. You need to have an interesting problem.
You have problem.
No, I mean, well, I'm very
Jenny
happy
is very
for
good
you.
To give problem to you. She assigned problem to me a lot as well.
Okay, we'll solve the problem.
Inventing the problem.
Yeah, okay. So I'm very happy for you, Boris, that you live a life with zero problems.
I have different problems.
When you're dead in a
okay. All have bye problems, bye. And I have to solve the problem. Okay.